So I want to talk to you today about the power of obedience. God intends and God expects and has provided to us all the grace that you and I need to be obedient. Even though I must admit that at times I just thought I didn't have much grace to be obedient to what God was asking. Or there were some times that at least I blamed it on God because I didn't want to do what he said to do. And I don't think there's anybody in here, that has not done that or said that. You know, God does not show us the big picture at one time. And it's a good thing because if we had known what we would be facing down the road, most of us would say, "Hi, pass that on to somebody else. You know, can I just kind of just walk along with everybody? I don't want this leadership position." And remember he told Abraham, leave where you are and go where I allow you to go or where I show you to go. I mean, have you ever really thought about Abraham? He was rich to start off with. And then this God, whom nobody really knew very well, shows up and says, leave everything you have, leave your family. Now, I know we have trouble with that. I mean, we can't even leave the church our family was a member of and go to another church because we're on the pew. Bought a stained glass window somewhere. You know, my family's always been here. I mean, our name's on this set of pews over here. We can't even break away from any kind of tradition. And here he's saying, leave where you are, go where I show you to go. And Abraham didn't know where he was going or how long it would take him to get there, wherever there was. God didn't tell him where there was. Just go there. There where? I know I would ask those questions. What do you mean there? Where's there? You see, to God, the destination wasn't the issue. The issue was Abraham being obedient. Amen. That was the issue. And if you walk with God for any length of time, I can promise you he will tell you to do things that you will not understand. Amen. There's a verse in 1 Samuel that has always puzzled me, to be honest. It's at the end of a story that we're all familiar with, and here it is in 1 Samuel 15. Samuel did not see Saul again until the day of his death, for Samuel grieved over Saul, and the Lord regretted that he had made Saul king over Israel. I never got that. What do you mean? I mean, the Lord regretted, you know, that he made Saul king. I mean, Lord, you made a mistake. God can't make mistakes. We need to understand what was going on here in 1 Samuel that caused the Almighty God and perfect God to say, I'm sorry I did that. God had spoken to his prophet Samuel to anoint Saul as king over Israel. You remember that? At the instruction of the Lord, Saul was raised up to a powerful and very prestigious position. Then God commissioned King Saul through the prophet, you know, Samuel, and to subdue Israel's enemies, Amalek. You remember that? 1 Samuel 15, 2 and 3. This is what the Lord of Heaven's armies has declared. I've decided to settle accounts with the nation of Amalek for opposing Israel when they came from Egypt. Are you catching on? Well, time's up. That's what he's saying. I remember. I hadn't forgotten. Time's up. Now go and completely destroy the entire Amalekite nation, men, women, children, babies, cattle, sheep, goats, camels, and donkeys. God wasn't playing. He had a serious dispute with the Amalekites and had decided that utter and complete destruction was the only option. I hope you're listening. Now, let me take you back for a minute to this, I regret that I made it him. It wasn't God saying he had made a mistake. It was God said, I had such a bright future. I had such plan for him. I wanted such, I hate that he chose to do his own thing. and not go the way that I had laid out for him. That's what he's actually saying. So the instruction was, wipe out the entire nation. Get rid of all the animals and everything. Wipe it out. Verse 4 and 5. So Saul mobilized his army at Telaim. Then there were 200,000 soldiers from Israel, 10,000 men from Judah. Then Saul and his army went to the town of the Amalekites and laid in wait in the valley. Saul followed the instructions, did what he was told to do from God through the prophet. So he started out right. Meanwhile, he sent a warning to the Kenites, who had shown kindness to Israel in 1 Samuel 15. Saul sent them this warning to the Kenites. Move away from where the Amalekites live, and you will die, or you'll die with them. For you showed kindness to all the people of Israel when they came up from Egypt. So the Kenites packed up and left. They paid attention, hallelujah. Then Saul, as you remember, attacked the Amalekites. So at this point, Saul is doing what God said to do. But suddenly there's a twist in this story that begins to happen. We find it in verses 8 and 9. This is Saul, what Saul did. He captured Agag, the Amalekite king, but completely destroyed everyone else. Saul and his men spared Agag's life and kept the best of the sheep and goats, the cattle, the fat calves, and the lambs, everything, in fact, that appealed to them. They destroyed only what was worthless or of poor quality. Don't act like you haven't done that. That's like sitting in church and the Lord says, you've got two bills in your pocket. You've got a 10 and a 100. Give the 100 to the church. And you say, I know God wouldn't be telling me to be left with only $10. So you give the 10. Nobody's listening. So God clearly and plainly gave instructions to Saul. There's no confusion. There's no mystery about what God said. Just like he's given clear and plain instructions to you and to me all of our lives. He's very clear and direct about what he wants from you. But the people had a better idea. They were fine with destroying what they considered worthless. But God did not give them the option to pick and choose. Now, let me tell you right here in these end days, you could find yourself picking and choosing if you aren't careful. The issue is not what God tells you to do. The issue is that God told you to do it. He told you what to do, and there's only one appropriate response. Yes, Lord. Obedience, church, is doing what God says, how he says it, and when he says it. Settle it firmly in your mind, church. God always says what he means and means what he says. Nothing about God is wishy-washy. So obedience is the only righteous response to a sovereign God, being obedient. We don't mind getting rid of things in our lives that we really don't want anyway. But these folks with Saul wanted to hold on to what they decided was good. Verse 9, Saul and his men spared Agag's life, kept the best of the sheep, and the goats, and the cattle, and the fat calves, and the lambs, everything. In fact, that appealed to them. They destroyed only what was worthless or of poor quality. They were willing to rid themselves of what they considered worthless and useless, but sheep and goats, cattle and lambs. They're saying, my goodness, this is a good food supply. I don't want to get rid of them. We might need them. We need beast of burden. And we justify what we need, and we said, God won't mind. We have no problem obeying God when we're comfortable with what he asks us to do. When God puts his finger on an attitude or a habit that hinders our relationship with him, that's when we do what Saul and his people did. We're unwilling to obey God because we want what we want. And we want it when we want it. And we want to do it our way. And surely God understands. I mean, after all, he's kind and loving. Verse 10 and 11. Then the Lord said to Samuel, I'm sorry that I ever made Saul king, for he has not been loyal to me and has refused to obey my command. Samuel was so deeply moved when he heard this that he cried out to the Lord all night. Newsflash, church. Never mess around with a true prophet. He'll read or she'll read every piece of mail you ever wanted anybody to see. Verse 12. Early the next morning, Samuel went to find Saul. Someone told him Saul went to the town of Carmel to set up a monument to himself. Then he went on to Gilgal. When Samuel finally found him, Saul greeted him cheerfully. May the Lord bless you, he said. I have carried out the Lord's command. You know, it's bad enough that Saul disobeyed. Now he's bragging about it. Saul declared, I carried out the command of the Lord. But look what Samuel said, verse 14. Then what is all the bleating of the sheep and goats and the lowing of the cattle I hear? Oh, Jesus, Samuel demanded. Oh, man. Now, here's what the prophet said. Saul, you're claiming one thing, but the evidence proves otherwise. Listen to this rationalization, verse 15. It's true that the army spared the best of the sheep, the goats, and the cattle. But I didn't do it, he said. Saul admitted. But they're going to sacrifice them to the Lord your God. We've destroyed everything else. They, he means the army. I didn't do it, he's saying. I didn't do it. They did it. And it was for a good reason, Samuel. The people are going to sacrifice to the Lord. And they wanted the best cattle and the best goats and donkeys and everything else. Not that I've ever seen a donkey sacrifice, but nevertheless, they saved the very best. And surely you can understand, Samuel. Look at verse 16. Samuel said to Saul, stop. What he's really saying is shut up today. Shut up. Listen to what the Lord told me last night. And then Saul said, well, what did he tell you, Samuel? I mean, Samuel was not about to be politically correct. He was not the least bit interested in giving Saul a pass, for the prophet knew the critical danger Saul was in because of disobedience. You have to remember that Samuel was standing before the king. I mean, Saul was king. He's rebuking the king. Saul could have killed him. He could have killed Samuel. But look at verses 17 through 19. And Samuel told him, although you may think little of yourself, are you not the leader of the tribes of Israel? The Lord has anointed you king of Israel. And the Lord sent you on a mission and told you, go and completely destroy the sinners, the Amalekites, until they're all dead. Why haven't you obeyed the Lord? Why did you rush for the plunder and do what was evil in the Lord's sight? Whew. Look at Saul's response. But I did obey the Lord, Saul insisted. I carried out the mission he gave me. I brought back King Agag, but I destroyed everyone else. Then my troops, they're the one who brought in the best of the sheep and the goats and the cattle and the plunder to sacrifice to the Lord your God in Gilgal. This is a classic exposition of a principle. I call it the almost but not quite attitude. Almost did it. Almost did it. Doing mostly what God said, but keeping certain habits or attitudes to yourself that you refuse to let go of and you won't deal with them. Church, Jesus is Lord. He has the right to establish what is acceptable, and he has the right to not accept what is not acceptable in the lives of his disciples. He has the right and the authority to be our absolute and uncompromising example. The story of redemption, church, is a story about leadership. Who's in charge and who rules? The leader leads and followers follow. It's that simple. No one can walk with God without being obedient. Obedience transforms you into the image and the likeness of Jesus. Obedience yields great rewards, both here on earth and at the Bema seat of Christ. Obedience is the key that opens every door in your life. Samuel was not swayed one bit by Saul's rationalization. That prophet did not move one bit. Look at 1 Samuel 15:22. But Samuel replied, "What is more pleasing to the Lord, your burnt offerings and sacrifices, or your obedience to his voice?" Listen, obedience is better than sacrifice. And submission is better than offering the fat of rams. Rebellion is as sinful as witchcraft, and stubbornness as bad as worshiping idols. So because you have rejected the command of the Lord, he has rejected you as king. Wow. What a tragic end to Saul's life. One God picked out to be the first king of Israel. He had great things in store for him. In closing, let me say this. Maybe you can say it and believe with me like I do. I really want to obey the Lord with how I think. Amen. I want to obey him in what I say. I want to obey him where I walk. I want to obey him in my relationships. And I want to obey him when he speaks to me, even when it's difficult. Now, this message really touched me. I don't want God to regret having called me to my destiny. I don't want God to regret having called you to your destiny. Church, the power that resides in obedience is this. Obedience utterly transforms you into the image and likeness of Jesus Christ. So the Lord just simply says, if you have business to do with God because, you know, of what you heard today, he said, I invite you to the altar to straighten it out so we can move with the blessings of God, because that's what he wants to give to us, are the blessings of God.